So I'm here, Kayla, or Kay Bear is my online name. I am a cosplayer and a student. I've been cosplaying now for 2 years, and I'm about to get my degree in sculpture. Yeah, I'm really excited. That I'm cosplaying. It's been a long road getting through college. I just ready to get it over with. But I've had a great time, and I've learned a lot through cosplaying and through my studies. And hopefully I can share some of my tips and tricks with you guys on how I make some of my props and armor. So I have some stuff up at the front here. If you guys want to come and take a look at it, play with it, or whatever, you're more than welcome to touch it. It's still just fine. But yeah, I'm just going to give you some tips and tricks, just the way I explain to you how I make my stuff, tips and tricks on how to take your armor from, you know, okay to another level up. And just making sure stuff looks really neat together and replicating the actual image that you're trying to make. So yeah, so we'll start off with the things you may want. So these are the materials that I use to make them. So you want Warbla is one of the main things I use, Warbla and EVA foam. So Warbla is a thermoplastic. I have little sheets here, and if you guys want to take a look at it, Warbla is the main thing I use. You can either get it in black Warbla, they have regular Warbla, and they also have a newer, clear Warbla that you can use for making different things as well. I typically only use the black and the regular brown Warbla, and I'll go into the differences on when to use each type, because they do two completely different things. Another really important item to have is EVA foam. This specific EVA foam is called L200, which you can find online. I usually go to a store called Engineer Guy, but if you just type in L200 online, you can find it basically anywhere. You can also use foam mats, like the workout foam mats work as well. The only issue I have with those is that one side is smooth and one side has like a rigid texture, so you kind of have to work around that. But the L200 is really good because both sides are really, really smooth. And I'll tell you guys how to make, I'll show you guys how to make armor out of this and what to use for prime, what to use the sand, because everything has a different method. The Warbla and the EVA foam work completely differently. There's one more type of foam you can use to make armor and props as well. I use this one mostly for props. This is just an insulation foam core board that I got from Home Depot. This is a half inch, but you can also get an inch size at Lowe's. The one at Lowe's is going to be pink, and you just find it all the way in the back, like where the wood and like the PVC pipes and all that, things like that. But yeah, I got this at Home Depot and Lowe's. It's really cheap, like $2 for a giant sheet, like this big, and $10 for like a panel like the size of that panel on the wall. So a little bit definitely. You want hot glue. Hot glue is something I use all the time, so let's talk about hot glue. Contact cement is another really good adhesive if you can't use hot glue. Sometimes if you use hot glue, it can eat through some of the materials you're using because it's hot, obviously. But the contact cement works very well as well. The way to use contact cement is you put a thin layer on each side, whatever two sides you're trying to glue together. You have to let each layer dry for about, I usually let it dry for about 5 minutes. They say 15, but I usually let it dry for about 5 or 10. I think it dries about that time. And then once you stick it together, there's the glue. So make sure that those are the two things you want to stick together, because once you get it together, they're not coming apart at all. And then you want different things to prime with. I'm really particular in priming my armor because a lot of those materials I use have a rigid texture or like bumpy texture that you want to get rid of. If you're making a sword or a cauldron, you want it to look like metal of some sort, which is also obviously very, very smooth. So I spend hours and hours and hours priming my stuff, priming and sanding to lose that rigid texture. So I can pass this around if you guys just want to take a look at some of my goodies. And they're not very fine. Just don't throw them, because they're still kind of sharp.
That one right there is an arm bracer.
This is a Samus paralyzer gun. And all of these are made out of these materials that I showed you here. And they're covered in spray paint. Protects me. Oh, you need some tears because a lot of these things are a little dangerous. So I'll tell you what to be careful, what's dangerous.
What type of PCB do you use for these elastic bands?
Either hot glue or contact cement. For the bracers, I just use hot glue for things like legs and arm connections. I use contact cement. Yeah, and then elastic. Some other things you may like to use are a Dremel tool. I got my Dremel tool on Amazon for $25, and it came with about 20 different bits you can use. Mine has a little charger that you plug into the wall, but if you're Dremeling a lot, it dies really fast, so I recommend if you get a Dremel tool, get one that like actually plugs directly into the wall, not one that has like a
Dremel tool?
Yeah, Dremel. And it gets pretty loud. Gnarly. I use this to Dremel beveled edges on my insulation of foam board. Or my L200 foam. But a quick tidbit, you don't want to Dremel all this stuff because it sends up particles in the air, so you don't want to Dremel it without using a mask or some sort of protection on your face. They have lots of different masks at Home Depot, and you want to get a particle dust mask. They have different types of masks. They have one for chemicals and like spray paint and stuff like that. Inside. I don't recommend doing it just inside, but if you must. Or get a particle dust mask to filter out any of the dust or particles that live in the air because it can make very sick. So you need a safety first if you have any of this stuff. But yeah, I use this Dremel tool and I use this sturdy little bit here. You don't want to pass around. Just be careful because your hair can get stuck in it. So I'm going to tell you guys all of the terrible things that happened to me so it doesn't happen to you. That's the bit, or Dremel bit, that I use to sand all of this stuff. So I recommend getting one of those. A wood burning tool is also very good. I didn't bring that one because it's a little dangerous. It's kind of sharp. But a wood burning tool is very good for getting, it gets hot. So it's a little hot metal tool, essentially. But it's made for wood, but you can use it on foam, and you can go in there and get these little cracks and weather details in there just to give your armor a look. And then I use it to like hit deep grooves as well. And you can see the groove in some of those pieces of mine. Just a little tidbit. This one is made completely out of foam. Yep. That one is just completely made out of the L200 foam. This one and the other sword I'm passing around for you guys is an insulation foam board core and then covered in the warp. And they're pretty sturdy as well. An X-Acto knife with sharp blades is also very important for cutting your foam.
Is this one giant sheet of foam that you can just cut your wall off?
That's actually two pieces. Because for that I use two pieces stuck together and then Dremel the edges down. Because I at the time couldn't afford to get the larger thick foam, but if you just want to get an inch, you can get that L200 foam up to 2 inches and then carve it down that way. But since I was short on money, I had to glue two pieces of the half inch foams together. So you could do that as well. The half inch is a little bit cheaper than the full inch. Let's see. So I'll go ahead and tell you the differences between regular Warbla and black Warbla and what I use them for. So this brown stuff right here is the regular Warbla. It's a thermoplastic, which means it's a plastic that's hard. When you heat it up with a heat gun, which I have here, my heat gun was also from Lowe's or Home Depot. It was like $20 and it has lasted me the entire 2 years that I've been making all of this stuff. And it's still going really strong. Yes, so the brown Warbla. You can get this at, you go to Warbla, WORBLA.com. You can find it there. I get locally in Atlanta from a store called The Engineer Guy. But they also deliver as well to wherever you are. So if you go to theengineerguy.com, you can buy from them. It's the same price as online, but it's cool. It's cool. So yeah, the regular warbler has a very fast heat time. So it only takes 30, 45 seconds to get it nice and soft so you can mold it around whatever shape you need. It bends around corners very, very easily, and it's great for covering small areas. So, let's see, which one did I use? This one here. I use the brown warbler for these cauldrons right here. And you can see it's got a lot of curves, a lot of really small details, a lot of intricate shapes here. This warbler is great for something intricate as such because it's good for pieces like that because it goes around small curves and details very easily without ripping. The only issue with the brown warbler is that it's very, very sticky and not very forgiving, so once you put the two pieces together, if you try to take them apart, it will just rip. So make sure, like I said, if you are putting two pieces together, make sure those two pieces that you want to stick together, that you may just have to remake it if you decide otherwise. It's strong and very sturdy. If I decide I want to throw it across the room on the wall, it's probably not going to break. Better than doing that, but if you want to, not. But the only con of the brown warbler is that it's got an extremely rough texture that's very hard to get rid of. So that warbler takes hours and hours of layers and layers of priming and sanding to get it very smooth to look like metal and marble. The black warbler, which is this one, this really goes well. It's a little bit more expensive. It's probably like $10 to $15 more expensive per roll wherever you get it, just because it's very new. Shiny product. But it's pretty cool. It's got pros and cons as well. It's got an even faster heat up time, which is good if you're working in a rush. You really want to get something done fast. It heats up in like 10 seconds and you can mold it very well. And it gets even softer than the brown warbler, which is good if you're trying to make like little small filigree decorations on your armor. But it rips very easily, so I don't recommend it if you're going over piece of armor, because once you try to do that, it gets so soft, it just starts to rip. So I recommend covering flat pieces with the brown or the black warbler. Something flat like this that you can just slap one side on here, slap one side on there, and you don't have to do much curving. It's less sticky than the brown warbler, and it forgives easier. This one, if you put two pieces together, and you don't like what it's doing, you can heat it back up and pull two pieces, pull it back apart. So that's really nice. So you'll save money in that way when you're using this one. So it's easier for beginners. And the cool thing about black warbler is it is so, so, so smooth. You pretty much don't have to do any priming at all. And you pass these two around so you can feel the difference in texture there. You pretty much don't have to do any priming at all. I still prime because I'm like really particular about it being smooth. But yeah, very smooth texture means less time priming, which is good for you. So when you're working with this plastic, things can get a little tricky. You can make mistakes. So let's say if you're working with a brown warbler and you do make a mistake, like if you get a hole or there's two pieces that don't line up properly. My little tidbit on fixing minor mistakes is using wood filler. I actually didn't bring my wood filler with me, but you get it in a little tub at Home Depot or Lowe's. I get a lot of my materials at Home Depot or Lowe's. Put it in a little tub at Home Depot or Lowe's, and it's made for filling in holes in wood, but you can use it for your plastic and your armor. You just take a little piece of the wood filler, fill in the hole, smooth it out, and you can sand it down with some regular sandpaper. And then when you actually go in and grind it afterwards, it smooths out any mistakes or imperfections you have. I wish I could show you guys right now. There's like a little tiny, I can't show you, it's so small. Sorry about that, I wish I could show you guys. Yeah, you just wait for the filler to dry and then sand it smooth, and then you'll yeah, after you put your armor together, or put your blade together, I'll tell you how that comes apart in a second. So this one is two pieces. It's one piece of the insulation foam board that I dribbled out and cut to this shape, right? So then I went in afterwards and used my wood burning tool, and then went in and carved out these little details in here with the wood burning tool. I then took two pieces of black warbler, and I heated up both pieces of black warbler and sandwiched the two pieces together and stuck them. And then went in with a pair of scissors and just cut along the shape of the blade and then let it dry. And then it gets super hard, super sturdy, so it's still pretty dangerous. But after that, yes?
How much work is
until it dries hard. With this stuff, I'd say like a minute or two, so I definitely keep my heat gun handy. Yeah, it dries pretty quick. I definitely keep my heat gun handy to keep heating up pieces. So usually I don't heat up the whole piece, I'll heat up a small piece and then stick it on, small piece, and work piece by piece, rather than heating up the entire, you know, large sheet of warbler, because by the time you get to the end, the front's gonna be dry, right?
Do you mean you cut it up into smaller pieces and then heat them up, or are you just talking about like the
pan? I'm heating up part by part. Okay. Yeah, exactly. But we'll move on to priming, what I use for priming. Priming is very important. Oh, sorry.
On the little preset for the design of the blade. Yeah. In the warbler in there, is there any special glue you use to push it in there? You just,
Use the end of a paintbrush to get in there. Yeah.
So I didn't know if it was still pliable. So you said it rips easily.
We gotta be careful. Yeah, it worked for this one. I did have a few rips in there, but I went in after it ripped and filled in with a wood filler, so you don't really see any of it. But yeah, it can get a little messy when you're trying to get in that hole, and then if you know, just your paintbrush or your knife or whatever just cuts right through the warbler. But luckily, that's what comes with fillers. You can go in and pretend that those, you know, that never happened. I'm just covering up. It's a big secret. but priming is very important. Oh, sorry, I keep missing my hands.
So use black warbler for details. So if you had used brown warbler, you wouldn't be able to fill in the crevices as easily, or?
It worked just as fine. It worked. Okay. The reason why I used black warbler for this was because it had a flat surface and it was already very smooth, and I wanted this to be super smooth. The brown warbler will fill in those creases easier than the black. The brown will go in there and probably will rip less. The black warbler, so if you try to go in there, will rip more, and you'll have to go in and fill in these creases. Okay. Yeah, because the black warbler gets softer. It is more malleable. The priming is very important. It removes the rough and bumpy texture of your work if you're working with warbler. But priming is also extremely important when you're working with foam, because foam is porous, which means it has holes. And without priming, if you try to paint it, the paint would just never dry. It just keeps soaking into the holes. It would not be shiny, it would not have a pretty surface, it would just be a mess. So it's very important to prime your warbler and your foam. My favorite primers are Rust-Oleum Filler Primer. There's this one right here, which I get at Home Depot. You also can use wood glue, which is very cool, also at Home Depot. I definitely recommend the interior use wood glue because it gives you a smoother texture. The exterior use has a naturally bumpy texture when you use it. Plasti-Dip is very good. And then Mod Podge also works well, but Mod Podge kind of takes a long time to dry. But I'll tell you when you should use different types of primers.
Is that a powder? The Mod Podge? What is that?
It's like a liquid glue. It's kind of like Elmer's glue. It's like, I haven't used it in so long. It's basically, I can show it to you. It's basically just Elmer's glue, like a little plastic that you can put on top of the foam to seal up any holes so it's easier to paint. So yes, Plasti-Dip. is important for priming foam. You do not use Placidip on Gorla because it is another plastic, as well as plastic. So if you use Placidip on Gorla, it will just peel right off. So, this is only foam. In order to prime foam the way I do, in regards to this one, to start off as this, you first cover it in, I usually do two layers of Mod Podge. There's another prop back there.
Found this in the hall.
Yeah, I left it in the hallway. I cover it in two layers of matte Mod Podge. I get this from Joann's, Walmart, Hobby Lobby, anything like that. It's just a few dollars. Let that dry. And then I cover it in two layers of Placidip. Placidip is a rubber coating. It's a multi-purpose rubber coating. People use it for lots of different reasons, but I use it for priming my foam. And then you let that dry, and with foam, there is no sanding required. You do your Mod Podge, you do your Placidip, once your piece is built, and it's ready to paint. In regards to Gorla, I use Rust-Oleum Filler Primer, which is right here. For the Rust-Oleum Filler Primer, it's really good. It fills in lots of little imperfections and gets rid of that like initial bumpy texture that the Gorla has, so it's a good starting primer. You can also use the Rust-Oleum Filler Primer on the foam instead of the Mod Podge, if you don't want to use the Mod Podge. So you can use those interchangeably. So I usually do three layers of Rust-Oleum Filler Primer on my Gorla, and I sand between each layer. Then after I do that, I do 4 to 6 layers of wood glue, let it dry, and sand between each layer. So I glue, dry, sand. Sand. Sandpaper is going to be your best friend. Also, please wear a mask when you're sanding because it lets your particles into the air. You can use whatever kind of sandpaper you want. If you like, I usually use medium. I start with a medium, and then right before I paint, I go with a fine-grained sandpaper. You can use the block. You can use the sheet, however you feel like using it. But yeah, just sand the crap out of your armor, because it really just completely takes away that awful bumpy texture that Gorla has. You can see the difference here. If you guys have looked at this one had only 2 layers of sanding and priming, and as opposed to this one, which I think I did like 8 layers of sanding and priming, so you can kind of see how much it is. Yeah, sanding's your best friend. You're going to hate it after you do like 10 hours of sanding on your armor, but it will be worth it. Another little tip that I have for making handles, like so. So this is a comma from Skate Club League Legends, and she has a curved handle on her blade. I know I needed to travel and fly with this. Sometimes your props can get big and you can't fit it in your suitcase. And obviously I don't want to let you walk around TSA with a freaking sword. So I decided I needed to make it snap into 2 pieces. So it fit nicely in my suitcase as such. What I did was I got a PVC pipe. Looks like this. This is just a small little piece that I cut off, but same thing. This is the inside core of what this looks like. And you can get a male and female PVC pipe connector. So the male part is on this side, and then you put the female part on this side. You can either get a screw or get one that just pops right in. I think I like the one that just pops right in better because it's screwing. It depends on whatever you need to make, because sometimes sometimes it can get in the way if you need to unscrew, so I just feel like having ones that pop in and out work better. But yeah, you just have the larger male part here, smaller female part on this side, and you just pop them right in. And I just covered this in a little bit of like fake leather from Joann's or wherever you get your fabric from to make it not look like a PVC pipe. You can heat this up with a heat gun. Heat it up for, it kind of takes a minute, heat it up for like 2 or 3 minutes, and you can bend this into any shape you want. Obviously it's not going to bend now, but once you heat it up, you can get that curved shape, however you like. And yeah, I just pop it right in. Okay, and then my painting. So metallic acrylic paints or metallic spray paints are my top choices. Rust-Oleum is awesome. Reason being is because you can handle it after spray painting, after like 15 minutes after spray painting, as opposed to other spray paints, you have to wait like an hour or two, and I don't have that kind of time. So I definitely go for Rust-Oleum because after I paint it, I just need to wait 15 minutes and I can touch it and sand it and play with it and do whatever I need to do. And it's pretty cheap. It's cheaper than most. I usually get, they're like $4 or $5 a can, and I can do a whole set of armor for like one or two cans. But I use metallic spray paint. Krylon's pretty good too, but I find that it doesn't have as nice of a smooth metallic like armor looking texture. But it works pretty well also, and also dries within about 10 to 15 minutes. But I swear by, when I'm making crops, I found this awesome spray paint from Rust-Oleum, and it's like hammer spray paint. It's not just like plain, flat, metallic. It, when it dries, it gives you this like hammer, rustic looking texture, which is awesome because then I don't have to go in and paint that on the armor after I spray paint. So yeah, hammered, well it depends on what you're looking for. If you're looking for like a rustic, you know, look, you're obviously going to go with hammered, but if you want something a little bit more pretty and shiny and flat, metallic. But you want to make sure you adequately prime your armor pieces before you spray paint, because the spray paint is a chemical, and if you don't properly prime it, or seal the foam, or seal your insulation foam, it will eat away at your armor piece. Airbrush works very well. A little bit of airbrush paint covers a lot of space. The only thing is, you gotta buy an airbrush machine, which can be a little pricey. It can be up to $100, $200. But it can be cost effective in the long run, because you're not having to buy, you know, 10 cans of spray paint. In regards to weathering, how I get my little darker edges here, a lot of people just like to use plain black metallic, I'm sorry, plain black matte acrylic paint. But I found a way that I like better. And my little trick is to use black oil paint instead of oil paint. Oil paint dries much slower, and obviously it's oily, so it's got a smoother texture than the acrylic paint. So the nice thing about it is that all of these were weathered with black hole paint. Every little dark area, anything that's raised or beveled in, I go in with a little dark black paint to really make the details pop. It dries slower than acrylic paint, so if you mess up, you can just take a napkin and wipe it off and dry. And I think it blends into the paint way smoother than acrylic paint. Acrylic paint can be kind of choppy and just dry way too fast, so it just gives you a much smoother texture. So that's my little secret to talk about. And yeah, I weather it all. Like I said, I weather every single crevice, every single hole, every single, everything. I weather everything. Because when you photograph it, it just shows up way more. Another little trick I use is if I need to get small rivets, yes, thank you, rivets, I use googly eyes. So my googly eyes, you can see here, no one's got another googly eyes, but yeah, you just stick them on once you paint them, they look like rivets. They come in all different sizes. You can get googly eyes that are like literally this big, you need a rivet that big, or you can get them very tiny. You can, obviously they have an eye in it, so you can go in there and like remove a little eye, but it's really tedious, but I don't, so they shave, so I use all my stuff with maracas. But you can go in there and remove it, but I don't, I kind of think it's cute when my carpet just shakes. Yeah. Those are my little tidbits. If you guys have any questions, I'm happy to answer anything for you if I didn't go over.
When you are going to do pieces of either hand or foam together, how do you kind of blend out that scene?
I go in with a bullet. yeah, I go in wood filler in all of my seams and holes, and yeah, sand down the edge really smooth. So this, when I put the two pieces of wardlet together, you can kind of see that there was like a line there where I put it. So I just went in and covered every single little inch here with the wood filler and sanded it down and then painted it. Usually when I do wood filler, I cover it in one more layer of priming afterwards too. If we do it just like a thin layer, just 10 minutes or so, but if you're covering like a really thick hole, I'd probably give it like an hour or two. If you're putting like half an inch or more wood filler, at least an hour, so it really dries solid. The good thing is, they have a wood filler now that is pink, and then it dries to brown, so that's how you'll know if you dry when it's completely brown. So that's the one I typically use, so I know when to start sanding it down.
Yes.
Oh yeah, so for like a breastplate like this, I found a styrofoam ball that was the same size as my bosom and more similar. Sometimes I get a bigger one just because I'm feeling it. And you just heat up the warbler and I just slowly bend it over the shape of the styrofoam. In regards to a helmet, you have to have a pattern for that. And you'd use foam and have pattern, but it's kind of tedious and long description, but I could point you to an online tutorial that I've used to make helmets, and I'll write it down for you. That'll be easier because I don't have all the materials to show you right now. I'm sorry. But Evil Ted Smith is awesome. He has lots of tutorials online. He's great, right? And Kabuki Cosplay also has a great helmet tutorial that you can purchase online.
What was this about?
Kabuki. K-A-M-U-I. She does amazing work. Yeah, I get most of my patterns from them. I'm not that great at making patterns, but when I have to, a little trick that I use to make patterns, like if I have to make like a breastplate pattern or like a thigh armor pattern, I will, it's really weird. I'll wrap myself in saran wrap first, and then I'll cover myself in duct tape. And then I'll draw the pattern on the duct tape, and then when you cut it apart, it's just perfectly molded to your body, to the shape and size that you need. But sometimes if I like can't get back there, I'll have someone help me draw the pattern. And but I also do that for sewing. Like if I need to make a shirt or a dress or a bodysuit, I'll wrap my entire body in saran wrap and like swim balls. And then draw it on me and then cut it apart, and then you can sew those seams just back together. It works.
It's not related to this, but just, what's your favorite anime?
I don't even know if I have a favorite anime.
Talk to
you. I like Bleach a lot. Are you guys going to judge me right now? I feel like I'm going to get judged if I don't give the right answer.
There is no wrong answer.
Yeah, I like Bleach. It's probably my favorite. I just recently watched that Dragon Maid since it's like really hype right now, and it's freaking awesome. I love Dragon Maid. And Full Metal Alchemist. I haven't watched it yet. Don't judge me. I know.
I always say watch the season 4 trailer, it's to your standards and it's
the season 4 trailer?
Season 4, season 5.
Okay.
That's
then
go
for it. I want to delve into it. It's really, I play a lot of, I used to be like
awesome.
The bad guys.
I watched one of the new ones and
it's kind of amazing. I used to be super anti-anime back in high school, but then I found video games, and I've been like a video game maniac since then. Yeah.
Quick second question. Team Sony or Team Xbox?
I'm sorry?
Sony or Xbox?
Sony? What kind of question is that? But I do like Halo a lot.
Yeah, see, that's
the same. I like Halo too, but yeah, definitely Sony. I like the interface of the PS way better. Sorry to any Xbox. I think that's all I have for you guys. But if you have any questions or need any more info, I'm happy to answer right now. Yeah?
Okay, so I was making a
And when I put a gloss finish over it, it really dulls down after you seal your metal. My metal is not sealed. That's just spray paint. I noticed that I try to do that, like I use like a gloss Mod Podge,
yeah.
Or I try to go with like a clear, like Rust-Oleum clear spray paint, and for some reason when you put that in your spray paint or clear sealant over the shiny metallic spray paint, it just like makes it, yeah, it like...
It makes it matte.
It makes it matte, and it doesn't make any sense, right? And then sometimes it will eat away at your weathering. It'll eat away the whole paint, so I usually don't. But I just make sure that it's the sanding and priming that really gives it like the smooth, shiny texture.
Right.
So I just make sure I go in and sand and prime a lot before I put in that.
So if you were to rub that oil, it won't really work?
It won't
it
move. Yeah, once it dries. Yeah, it won't move.
Okay.
Yeah, it just takes a long time to dry. It takes like, not a long time, like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
But it still gives you time to go back and fix your mistakes if you make it too dark. But yeah, don't go in and put a clear sealant over your stuff because it like totally explodes it. But that's why I like Rust-Oleum, because their stuff always comes out like super shiny and super metallic compared to any other spray paint I've used, definitely. But I also use, oops, I forgot to show you guys this stuff. Folk Art at Joann's has really good metallic, just metallic paint that comes out looking really, really shiny too. This stuff right here, this gold part, was just a plain Folk Art acrylic paint, so it still came out pretty shiny. It's just using a lot of sanding and priming underneath it, I think. And then this brand, Dazzling Metallics, also works really well for shiny. Yeah.
I was actually going to ask another question. I haven't rode on an airplane in like 13 years or so, and I was wondering like, what are like other great tips of like, you know, packing armor and such for like traveling?
So like they don't ruin it?
Yeah.
So TSA, they give you some issues. I had a friend that made an awesome costume for BlizzCon last year and had tons of scales on it. And I guess they thought there was drugs in the scales or something, and they picked off like all of your scales off the armor. So sometimes they're just going to be ridiculous and so just a tidbit. I wish I could do something at TSA, but sometimes they're weird about that. But so stuff doesn't get damaged, I usually wrap it up in towels. Is a good alternative. Old towels, because once you wrap it up, it may kind of smell like spray paint afterwards, and it may make the spray paint smell out. Or bubble wrap. I also invested in a really awesome hard shell suitcase, and I slapped like 50 fragments of this all over the and so they don't mess with it. But yeah, I wrap it in either bubble wrap, I wrap it in the towel. I've had the bubble wrap plastic stick to the paint sometimes, so that it might rip off the paint, so be careful when using rubber back. Bubble wrap, maybe wrap it in some paper or like paper towels before and then put the bubble wrap on. But usually I just use towels. If you're using Orbla, your stuff typically won't get damaged because it's got such a hard texture. But if you're using foam, be careful. Make sure you have, you can make like a little cardboard box sometimes. So I've got the little cardboard box and put my stuff in that and then put it in the hard shell case. Because obviously the foam will still bend and it can cause it to. Usually it doesn't crack or rip, but it may just give it like, you know, bends or ripples or whatnot. So maybe it's some cardboard and whatnot.
For
new
phones, we have issues of possible bending a lot. Do you put anything inside of it to make it even more solid?
Not really. I say if you want something. So like I have an idea. So
like
has these little like you see for those signs outside for like dopamine type signs. It's just inside here.
Gotcha. Well yeah, that it's still a little bit. What did you use for
that? It's the like you see it for like the signs that I don't know how you, it's like it has the same basically designed as cardboard, but it's made out of plastic.
Corrugated plastic.
Oh, okay, I think I can talk about it.
Corrugated plastic.
So what I would recommend is a different method of priming. Wood glue hardens rather than, okay, so if you're priming foam, you can use the rubber placidative that will keep it malleable, but if you have like a straight prop that doesn't need to move, wood glue is very good for priming because it hardens when it dries. So if you do like, it'll take a lot of wood glue, like 5 or 6 layers of just wood glue before you prime and paint. It'll harden up a lot, and that's usually what I do
for props. Did I do this like a prop that I made 3 years ago? It's really old. I had to re-glue something. But it's just this one part, it kept on bending. Like, so I ended up having to put some of that board in there, but it's still not strong enough.
Yeah, I'd say the cover of the wood glue helps a lot. The wood glue is really tough. Structure is
I was going to mention that I got some information on how to ship stuff. One of your friends mentioned the golf club bag. Mm-hmm. It's a hard case golf club
bag. Oh, yeah. So if you have like a large prop and you can ship it or fly with it, you can use a giant golf club bag. And instead of buying like maybe you can go to like Goodwill or Pop Shop, and you usually have it there. Ship it. And my friend, I wish I knew exactly what the name was. She got this giant, like, suitcase. It was like thin suitcase. I don't know how to explain it. It was a giant, like, square suitcase that she wanted to use for a prop, and it was like $15 on Amazon. I don't know how to explain it, but yeah, it was just a thin black bag essentially, and she took a few pieces of cardboard and like foam core board and put it in between, like, sandwich it in between her. I'm sorry?
Was it like a snowboarding bag?
I guess you could, yeah. Basically, like a large, skinny bag, and then covered it in 2 layers of like this insulation foam board, which is pretty like hard to break, and then wrapped it in bubble wrap, and then put it in the bag, and then put a bunch of practice stickers over it. And then she shipped it that way, and that worked pretty well. And usually if it's like covered in a lot of like plastic and bubble wrap, TSA won't go through the, you know, trouble of like undoing all of that. So that's another way to protect your stuff from the evil airport. Yeah, I like get so much anxiety when I fly now because I'm afraid they're going to tear my stuff apart. So definitely cover as much crap as you can so they're not, they're like, oh, I'm not going to go through it on moving all this bubble wrap. Yeah.
So do you have any advice on, like a toolbox, if let's say day one you're in the office, you're wearing down, you have some sort of repair kit, you recommend going to take it on the show?
My repair kit consists of a sewing needle and thread, black sewing needle and thread, hot glue works a lot. I always carry my contact cement with me also, and extra elastic. Usually the parts that break on my armor is the attachments. It's rarely the actual piece that breaks, is when I'm taking care of it. It stays together, but you know, sometimes someone can bump into it and the end will snap off or whatnot. So contact cement is my go-to because when I put those 2 pieces back together, the chances of those pieces snapping apart are less than another piece snapping apart. So yeah, usually hot glue, sewing needle and thread, scissors, an X-Acto knife, the contact cement, and some extra paint, always, because sometimes with usage, it can start to chip off, so I'll come in with some extra paint and like touch it up just in case if it gets a little wet. Okay,